Welcome back to our online course in health psychology. This is the final video in the series that we've put together for you. In today's final lecture, we dive into the fascinating world of complementary and alternative medicine, or CAM for short. CAM encompasses a wide range of health-promoting interventions that fall outside of conventional Western medicine. So grab your notepads and get ready to explore the world of natural and holistic therapies. We'll also explore the future of health, wellness, and health psychology. What lessons have we learned, and what are our future challenges? Before we jump into CAM, we first have to address the elephant in the room with some of the domains found in CAM. That's the placebo effect. What is a placebo? Well, simply put, it's any medical procedure that produces an effect in a patient because of its therapeutic intent. It's not its specific nature. The most common example? The good old sugar pill. But what makes the placebo effect stronger? Well, a number of things, actually. The behavior of your healthcare provider can make a big difference. Confidence and warmth can go a long way. As your belief in the treatment, yes, believing it will work really does help. Situational factors, like how medical the placebo seems, or how expensive it is, can also boost the placebo effect. And let's not forget societal norms. Faith in modern medicine plays a big part too. Fun fact, placebos helped 60% of Germans in one study compared to just 7% of Brazilians. Now, what's at the heart of the placebo effect? It's all about patient expectations. You don't need to have prior experience with a drug for a placebo to work. The more believable the placebo, the more likely it is to work. And here's a brain twister for you. A placebo can sometimes do the opposite of an active drug. But remember, there are no cases of placebo effects without some form of expectation. Now, complementary and alternative medicine, or CAM, revolves around three key ideals: providing natural treatments, taking a holistic approach, and promoting overall wellness. However, skeptics raise concern about the lack of empirical evidence and safety assessments for many CAM therapies. They argue that without rigorous scientific scrutiny, it's challenging to evaluate the effectiveness and potential risks associated with these interventions. On the other hand, CAM practitioners assert that holistic treatments are inherently challenging to subject to scientific scrutiny since they often involve interconnected variables. Now, CAM is all about the holistic approach, looking at the physical, mental, and emotional spiritual needs of an individual. The term alternative might sound like it's a replacement for traditional medicine, but that's not the case. It's used in conjunction with, that's the complementary part, with traditional methods, hence why we often say complementary medicine. CAM comes in many shapes and sizes, and this is not an exhaustive list. It can be alternative medical systems by non-Western cultures, mind-body interventions like meditation and hypnosis, biologically based therapies like dieting or herbal supplements, manipulative or body-based therapies like chiropractic, which is pretty popular in the United States, or massage therapy, also really popular in the United States, or even energy therapies like Qigong or magnet therapy. There are three core ideals of CAM: natural medicine, holistic medicine, and promoting wellness. Natural medicine is all about the back to nature trend, using natural materials for healthcare. Holistic medicine focuses on the whole person rather than just the disease. As a famous doctor, Patch Adams, said, "Treat the disease, you win or you lose. Treat the person, and you win every time." And promoting wellness is about strengthening the individual, not just treating the disease. But how widespread is CAM? And is it effective? Well, many people are drawn to CAM due to the costly and impersonal nature of traditional care, and who can blame them? The adverse effects of some treatments, and the perception of a profit-driven healthcare system. But as science enthusiasts, we must critically evaluate CAM just like we do with traditional medicine. And there are two main views on this. Biomedical researchers argue that CAM should be tested under rigorous scientific trials, while alternative medicine proponents are often satisfied with minimal, albeit less scientifically rigorous, evidence. Critics often point out that CAM studies appear unfocused and lack proper samples and hypothesis testing. There's also specific pitfalls like participant selection, self-reported outcome measures, and participant expectancy, which we mentioned a little bit ago, which can lead to the placebo effect. So the bottom line is this. Do your due diligence when it comes to CAM. Research claims, question sources, and above all, keep an open but critical mind, as we talked about in the second video of this series. The growing interest in integrative medicine is seen by many as a sign of a major paradigm shift in healthcare. A survey reveals that patients, primary care physicians, and CAM practitioners have differing expectations regarding the use of CAM in primary care settings. This highlights the need for open communication and collaboration between these providers and their patients when considering CAM as part of a comprehensive treatment plan. So that was a glimpse into the diverse world of CAM. As we explore these therapies, it's essential to approach them in an evidence-based mindset while recognizing the significance of individual preferences and experiences. Remember, CAM can provide valuable options for promoting health and well-being, but it's important to consult with qualified professionals and maintain open communication with your healthcare team. For the second half of this video, I want to explore what the future of health psychology looks like in the 21st century and as we move through the 2020s. Health psychology has made significant strides since its recognition by the American Psychological Association 4 decades ago. And so this part of the video is going to focus on the 4 valuable lessons that we have learned as psychologists and as learners, and then the ongoing challenges that face us in the future. So let's talk about lesson 1 and lesson 2 here. Psychological and social factors interact with biology in health is lesson 1. This fundamental lesson highlights the intricate interplay between genetics, microorganisms, stress, emotions, coping resources, healthy behaviors, and social integration in determining our susceptibility to disease, unwellness, their progression, and our chances of recovery. Lesson 2 is that our health is largely our responsibility, our own responsibility. This lesson marks a significant attitude shift from previous generations, with individuals taking ownership of their physical, social, and psychological well-being. Positive progress has been made in achieving targets outlined in Healthy People 2020 3 years ago, such as reducing smoking rates and increasing physical activity levels. 1.5 years till the World Health Organization wants to see that 10%. We can do it. Lessons 3 and 4 are about what has to happen. Unhealthy lifestyles are harder to change than to prevent. Prevention plays a pivotal role in curbing the development of poor health habits. Initiatives are underway, including educating new parents on how to install healthy eating habits and promote aerobic fitness in their children from an early age. But we also can't forget to promote good health behaviors. Prevention of bad health is one way. Promotion of good health is another way. And finally, stress is in the eye of the beholder. Learning to manage stress adaptively is vital for our overall well-being, encompassing physical, psychological, and emotional aspects of our lives. This is critical because stress can be good, but also stress can be bad. And it depends on you to determine which one it will be and how much it will impact your life. All stress behaviors and coping are allowed. You can do anything you want. Some work in the short term, some work in the long term. Don't try to do the ones that work in the short term, like avoidance. And don't try to do the long-term ones in the short term, like problem-focused coping, when more emotion-focused coping is better. And finally, as health psychology moves forward, it faces five key challenges aligned with the goals in Healthy People 2020, which I think is now Healthy People 2030. Challenge one, increasing the lifespan for all. This challenge emphasizes a strength-based preventative approach to research and interventions with a focus on promoting health and well-being across the lifespan. Challenge two is reducing health disparities and understanding the impact of race, gender, culture, and socioeconomic status on health. By addressing these factors, health psychology aims to ensure equitable health outcomes for all individuals. Challenge three, achieving equal access to preventative healthcare services. It is crucial to identify and overcome the barriers that limit access to healthcare, thereby ensuring that everyone has the opportunity to benefit from preventative measures. Challenge four, maximizing health promotion through evidence-based approaches. With healthcare costs being a concern, massive concern, and access to care not uniformly available, health psychologists can contribute to healthcare reform by advocating for the widespread application of evidence-based preventative policies. And then finally, challenge five, assisting in healthcare reform by emphasizing prevention, promotion, and advocating for more accessible and cost-effective healthcare. Health psychologists can play a pivotal role in driving positive changes within the healthcare system. Health psychology has indeed come a long way. As we conclude this course, we recognize the invaluable lessons and the challenges that lie ahead. By embracing a holistic approach, focusing on prevention and promoting equitable access to healthcare, health psychologists have, and you, have the power to shape a healthier future for individuals and communities. Remember, your health and well-being are in your hands. By taking responsibility, managing stress, adopting healthy behaviors, and seeking the support when needed, whether it's friends, family, or coworkers, you can enhance the quality of your life. Thank you for joining us on this journey of exploration and empowerment. I am wishing you a lifetime of health and happiness. Stay healthy, stay well. See you later.